These are sulfonamides, the first drugs that made a meaningful impact on humans' ability to survive bacterial infections. These drugs came out before penicillin and changed infectious disease medicine virtually overnight. So in this video, we'll ask, how did sulfa drugs become a thing? How did they actually change the day-to-day practice of medicine? And how did they spread? How did they go from discovery to distribution? The story starts in turn-of-the-century Germany. By the early 20th century, a little dyestuff company called Bayer had become incredibly rich thanks to two drugs, aspirin in 1899 and heroin in 1898. But their director, Carl Duisberg, had been following the business strategies of American companies and knew they could make a ton more money by acquiring their competitors in the dye market, the good old Standard Oil playbook. Germany had the biggest dye industry in the world at the time, and most dye companies had some kind of pharmaceutical division to make medicines, so consolidating the German dye companies would effectively create a global monopoly of dyes and some drugs. In 1904, the companies Hoechst and Casella merged, and shortly after, Bayer merged with BASF and then Agfa. Then World War I happens, and those two mega companies merge in 1916. Germany then loses World War I, which causes a couple things to happen. Number one, the United States confiscated the American branch of Bayer's business, which included aspirin production. They sold it to an American drug company called Sterling Drug for $5.3 million in 1918. Bayer wouldn't get back American aspirin rights until 1994 when they bought it for $1 billion, making it a billion-buck Bayer buyback, if you will. Germany still got to keep German aspirin production, but 80% of the dye conglomerate's revenue came from exports, so they lost some of their biggest markets after the war. Number two. Between 1921 and 1923, Weimar Germany experienced extreme hyperinflation, which subsided by the mid-20s. Bayer survived, but it was clear that the industry wouldn't achieve the global market share it had before the war. So in 1925, Bayer and five other German dye companies did an even bigger merger and became the Community of Interest of Dye Businesses, but in German. I'm going to refer to it as IG Farben or IGF for this video. IGF made everything from dyes to pharmaceuticals, but other than neosalversan and some new antimalarials like adabrin, they didn't have many moneymakers. So they decided to go down the road of antibiotic development, which was in a bit of a lull. In the last video, we talked about Paul Ehrlich and salversan, a drug that treated syphilis. But after 20 years, there still wasn't anything new to treat everyday infections. So in 1927, scientists at IG Farben started working on their own version of antibiotics by testing individual compounds one by one. This was the same strategy that Ehrlich used for salversan. And when they had a hint that a compound might work, they sent it off for more robust testing with Gerhard, the director of Bayer's Institute of Pathology and Bacteriology. Domagk was a German physician-turned-researcher, and in order to test all these potential antibiotics, he created a supercharged strain of Streptococcus pyogenes that would kill his experimental mice every time. So before we go much deeper into the antibiotics, we need to talk about the biology of strep infections. Streptococcus is a genus of ball-shaped bacteria that live all around our bodies, and they don't all cause disease. They're gram-positive, which, if you remember from the last video, means they stain a purple color thanks to their peptidoglycan cell wall. And this cell wall's got a bunch of little projections and adhesive proteins that let them stick to their host cells like Velcro. But Velcro only sticks to Velcro. Strep can stick to all kinds of human tissue, and because of that, they can cause a ton of different types of diseases that range from mildly inconvenient to deadly. And there are two types of strep infections. Group A, which cause diseases from strep throat all the way to toxic shock syndrome and sepsis, and group B, which cause blood infections and pneumonia. So strep infections are common and potentially deadly. Streptococci are mostly spread from person to person, and they can live on all kinds of surfaces, like outside on the skin or inside on the throat. But they can cause more severe, system-wide problems because they have some tricks for getting around the immune system. Normally, when germs get into your body, your immune system sends less specialized immune cells to the scene to gobble up whatever pathogens they find. But Streptococci A are wrapped in a capsule of hyaluronic acid, which lets them mimic human cells. And they secrete a few chemicals that let them resist that initial gobbling. They can also go on the offense and secrete toxins that attack immune cells, poking holes in their cell membranes. Then they can more easily get into the bloodstream where they can spread around the body. From there, strep can become life-threatening when the bacteria release chemicals that disrupt normal cell function. They also have something called, and I'm not making this up, superantigens, which cause an overreaction of the host's immune system. This can cause organ failure and eventually death. And death rates vary, but the takeaway is that your chance of death increases once the strep has gone system-wide, or gotten into the blood. By the early 20th century, a few industrialized countries had cut down on strep infections thanks to improved hygiene, but they still needed treatments for when someone got infected. Which brings us back to our scientists at IG Farben. Domagk had created a line of strep that consistently killed test mice within a day or two. This was no mild strep throat. The scientists who made that first antibacterial, salvarsan, based their drug on a dye called aniline, which sometimes had toxic side effects. So, the IGF scientists started focusing on azo dyes instead, which they thought were less toxic. The important chemistry part to know for this story is that azo dyes have two nitrogens bonded together. And from there, you can plug different chemicals into these slots and get all kinds of azo dyes. And IG Farben's main chemist did exactly that, and systematically created over 3,000 hopeful antibacterial candidates by 1931. This was as close to throwing stuff at a wall and seeing what sticks as you can get. They tried side chains of chlorine, arsenic, and iodine with mixed success. One of those compounds, KL487, killed a few strep and wasn't immediately lethal to the mice, so that was good. And they had a few other hopeful antibacterial chemicals, but no clear blockbusters. But then they started experimenting with sulfur, and landed on KL730, a dye that contained a compound called sulfanilamide. And this was an interesting little antibacterial candidate, because it had already been around since 1909 as a red dye called Prontosil, but nobody really thought much of it. But even more interesting was the mechanism. They noticed that it didn't do anything against streptococci cells in a petri dish, but it made them totally disappear in a live animal. Ineffective in vitro, very effective in vivo. Remember that, we're gonna come back to it later. So in 1932, the chemist sent some Prontosil to Domagk to start testing. On December 20th, 1932, Domagk injected 26 mice with massive amounts of streptococci, more than 10 times the amount needed to kill them. He took 14 of them and kept them as controls, and took the other 12 and gave them a single dose of Prontosil. On Christmas Eve, he saw that every mouse in the control group had died, and every mouse that had been given Prontosil was alive. This moment was seen as the discovery of sulfonamides. IG Farben realized that they had a moneymaker on their hands, so they might as well lock up the intellectual property rights in case Prontosil ended up being a big deal. So, on Christmas Day of 1932, literally the day after the mouse experiment, IGF filed a new patent for Prontosil. And while the mice results were dramatic, Domagk wasn't so sure it would be safe in people. So IGF started human trials in 1933, which went well, other than the fact that it temporarily turned the patient's skin bright red, which was a totally fine side effect when the alternative was potentially death. Domagk and the crew also found that Prontosil was effective against more than just strep, like staphylococcus and pneumococcal infections. And once the drug was more widely available, it was also shown to be effective against puerperal fever, also known as childbed fever. This can happen when the person delivering a baby carries Streptococcus pyogenes on their hands, which introduces strep directly into the mother's bloodstream. It was one of the things that made childbirth so dangerous for so long. Rates are different all around the world, but in the 1930s, about 300 out of every 10,000 new birthing mothers in the UK contracted puerperal fever, and 49 of them died from it. But studies showed that Prontosil dropped the mortality rate from about 20% to 4.7%. Interestingly, sulfa drugs were also effective against gonorrhea. This is interesting because strep is a gram-positive bacteria, while gonorrhea is gram-negative. And if you remember from our last video, that means that their cell walls are built differently. And this phenomenon hinted that maybe Prontosil's antibiotic effect would be more wide-reaching than expected. Either way, human trials were looking good. But at this point, a few years had passed since Domagk's rats experiments, and he still hadn't published anything. And while nobody really knows why there was such a long gap, the biggest reason is probably money. IG Farben knew they had a winner, but if they released the news before having a product to offer, competing companies would read their research and beat them to market. Plus, the idea of a drug that could cure strep infections was brand new, so these clinical trials were a way of building trust in a new class of drugs. Basically, it was in IGF's financial interest to do more research before they let the news out. So finally, in early 1935, IG Farben lets/makes Domagk publish in a German-only journal. That year, they also released Prontosil to the market. But even with this research, there was a lot of doubt. Prontosil seemed too good to be true. Luckily, there were two big stories that lent it some more emotional credibility. In late 1935, Domagk's six-year-old daughter, Hildegard, suffered a puncture wound from a sewing needle. The wound got infected, and none of the treatments they tried did anything. The infection eventually spread through her whole arm and would have spread throughout the rest of her body, but right before making the decision to amputate her arm to save her life, Domagk snuck her some Prontosil. For the first few days, her fever went up and down unpredictably, but after a while, she stabilized and ended up surviving. And Prontosil sales started picking up soon after. What started at 175,000 marks in sales in 1935 climbed to a million marks the next year. And another bump came in December 1936, when President FDR's adult son, Franklin Jr., was admitted to the hospital for a severe strep throat infection. The infection got worse, and the doctors worried that the president's son would go septic and die. Luckily, his doctors were paying attention to the antibiotic stories coming out of Germany, so they gave Roosevelt injections of Prontosil, and gave him the oral version, Prontolin. He recovered within a few days, and all of a sudden, these little sulfanilamide drugs had a celebrity endorsement in the US, and sales followed suit. Prontosil went from 1 million marks in sales to 5 million marks in 1937, the year after Roosevelt's treatment. But there were still tons of open questions. Like, scientists still couldn't explain how the drug could kill bacteria in the body but not in a petri dish full of bacteria. Plus, this was set in Germany in the late 1930s. We're not exactly heading towards more scientific collaboration. Before long, news started spreading throughout the international scientific community about this new antibacterial, and scientists at the Pasteur Institute in Paris wrote to IG Farben, saying, "We'd sure like to test whatever it is you got over there." Not surprisingly, the German said no. Nine. So, the Pasteur Institute scientists got to work with what they had. Because even though the German researchers were being real mysterious about what they were testing, the French had been following the clinical trial throughout 1933 and 34. And as soon as Domagk's study came out in 1935, the French team started studying the structure of Prontosil, hoping they could reverse engineer it. And in November 1935, just 9 months after Domagk's publication, the Pasteur Institute scientists published a bombshell of a paper, which translates to "Activity of Sulfanilamide on Experimental Streptococcus Infections of Mice and Rabbits." It's a short article with a big impact. They start their paper giving credit to Domagk, and describe how they'd created and tested a bunch of azo dyes of their own, including a couple with sulfonamide side chains. Then they tested how good they were at eliminating streptococci in mice and rabbits. They found that it didn't matter what was in slot A, as long as sulfanilamide was in slot B, it killed strep bacteria. More importantly, they also tested sulfanilamide without the dye, and it was equally as effective as brand name Prontosil against streptococci. Therefore, they reasoned that something in the body was splitting the bond between the active ingredient and the dye. That created a free sulfanilamide, which was the only relevant antibacterial agent. The azo dye didn't matter one bit, it just broke apart in the body anyway. Back in Germany, the IG Farben chemist confirmed what the French found. The only compound in Prontosil that had an effect was sulfanilamide. And it turned out it didn't just treat strep, it was good at treating staph infections too. Now, unfortunately for the poor, poor pharmaceutical companies, sulfanilamide by itself was already in the public domain and couldn't be patented. So, drug manufacturers around the world started cranking out their own homegrown sulfa drugs, since the only thing differentiating one drug from another was branding. Like, the American pharma company, Winthrop Chemical Company, came up with Prontolin, the brand used on FDR Jr., the Dutch had Streptopan, Brazil had Stoptin, Japan had Patanol, France had 5 versions of sulfanilamide, and the UK had 30. Ultimately, there were over 100 competitors to Prontosil by 1937. And this answers one of the questions I asked in the intro. Sulfa drugs spread so quickly because every drug company in the world could make their own. And this meant that all of a sudden, IGF's brand new blockbuster drug was worthless. The 5 million marks I mentioned earlier seemed big, but their profits would have been massive if they had access to a truly global market. By the way, don't feel sorry for IG Farben. Their leadership was found guilty of a ton of war crimes after World War II, including the use of concentration camp slave labor, so I'm not sad they lost out on profits. But the sulfanilamide story isn't over. Like, they had all this clinical data showing it treated infections, but didn't really know how the body metabolized the drug yet, or how it worked on a cellular level. They figured out metabolism first. In 1936, a team of British scientists showed that unlike Prontosil, sulfanilamide could kill strep bacteria in a petri dish. And the same team found that you could inject Prontosil into an animal, then if you took their blood serum and put that into a petri dish, that serum could kill strep. These plus a few other experiments in 1937 were plenty of evidence for the theory that the body separated the azo dye from sulfanilamide, and that it was actually sulfanilamide doing the heavy lifting. And that's awesome, but we still needed to learn how it worked. In 1936, American scientists at Johns Hopkins concluded the drug was bacteriostatic, meaning it keeps bacteria from growing, as opposed to bactericidal, meaning it kills bacteria. Knowing this, future researchers looked into how that worked. And in 1940, a team of British scientists proposed an idea that ended up being right. In order to replicate, bacteria need to copy their genetic material, and there are a bunch of chemicals needed to make that happen. One of which is folate. Unlike our bodies, which get folate directly from our diets, some bacteria, like strep, have to make folate from other chemical ingredients. And one of those ingredients is para-aminobenzoic acid, or PABA. If they can't use PABA, they can't replicate. Sulfanilamide has a really similar structure to PABA, so when you take sulfa drugs, they take PABA's spot in the process, which keeps the bacterium from making folate, and therefore from replicating. Technically, it's called a competitive antagonist drug, meaning it swaps in where PABA would go otherwise and keeps it from exerting its effect. Now, while all this scientific research was mounting, sulfanilamide was getting more use in the hospital setting. Unfortunately, it wasn't perfect. Bacteria developed sulfa resistance in less than a decade thanks to overprescription by doctors, and there were some side effects like nausea and a temporary reduction in kidney function. But one of the biggest problems was its lack of solubility. It didn't dissolve in water, so you'd have to take it as a powder. And if any of you have ever tried to eat a spoonful of cinnamon before, I also lived through the dumb viral challenges of 2011, then you know how hard that is. A Tennessee-based company called SE Massengill tried to solve this problem by dissolving sulfanilamide in diethylene glycol, which turned the powder into something more like cough syrup. Unfortunately, diethylene glycol is modern antifreeze. But this was before you had to get approval prior to selling a drug, so their elixir of sulfanilamide hit the market in October 1937, and people started dying right away. That fall, a report documented that at least 76 people died from toxic levels of diethylene glycol associated with the drug. But because of the pharmaceutical laws at the time, Massengill technically only got in trouble for mislabeling their product. They marketed the drug as an elixir, which had a technical definition. That meant it should have alcohol in it. They didn't get in trouble for killing people, they got in trouble because they promised the American people alcohol and gave them antifreeze. Can't do that. The report led the United States to give actual regulatory power to the Food and Drug Administration, which is an appropriate response. Probably should have done it sooner. The authors of the report commented that Massengill hadn't done any kind of safety checks on humans or animals, and companies should be required to submit something prior to approval from now on. The result was the Food, Drug, and Cosmetics Act, which was passed in 1938 and required formal approval before a new drug came to market. This would lead to some weird gray areas when it came to generic drug regulation, though. But you can check out my video on that story here. Obviously, this wasn't great for sulfanilamide's reputation, but new and improved sulfa drugs came to market soon afterwards. After all, once you remove the antifreeze, they're still useful. New sulfa drugs were effective treatments for pneumonia, gonorrhea, meningitis, and a few other infections. They lasted longer and were better tolerated by patients, and doctors still use some of them today for things like burns and ulcerative colitis. But starting in the 1940s, sulfa drugs were replaced by more effective antibiotics, which finally brings us to the topic you've all been waiting for. Let's talk about penicillin.